my brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, we want to first thank you for taking the time to come out here in Harlem this afternoon to this unity rally. But I think before we go into our unity rally, we should give another round of applause first to the steel band that played earlier. And to Gus Venizulu and his African drummers and dancers who just finished. They made us feel right at home. Not down home, but back home. The only time you feel, or the only time you remember down home is when you see a rope. That's the number one memory that we attach to down home. But back home, our people are happy. A happy people. We love to sing and dance. We love to be in unity and harmony. We love to do things together. This is the African way. This is our way. We never knew anything about disunity and inharmony until we were kidnapped by the white man and brought here to America, divided against each other, and then used against each other. So we want to welcome you to our rally, our unity rally, for a united black front. To unite all factions of our people. To unite every one of the 20 million so-called Negroes into one group. And you'll notice, whenever the white man thinks that we're going to call a rally to knock our own kind, you see him jammed out here. He wants to hear us say something against King or against Bunch or against Farmer, against someone of our own kind. He jams out here. But when you call a rally for black people to unite, let's get together, you don't see too many white folks there. They don't like black people to get together in unity and harmony. As long as you and I are going to attack each other or talk about each other or heap scorn and ridicule upon each other, the white man gets his kick. But when he knows that we're going to come together in unity and harmony, he won't get his kick. He will get kicked. So, in calling this unity rally, we invited Dr. Adam Clayton Powell, Dr. Roy Wilkins, Dr. Whitney Young, Dr. James Farmer, Dr. Edward Davis, the Right Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Dr. Gardner C. Taylor, Dr. Ralph Burt, Dr. A. Philip Randolph, Professor James Lawson, and Dr. James Foreman. We invited all these so-called Negro doctors to come out and, since they are doctors, give their analysis, their diagnosis of the ailments that our people are afflicted with here in America. And after giving their diagnosis to this vast audience here in Harlem, then we wanted them to offer their solution. We told them that if they came out, give you and me, us here in Harlem, some idea of what we can do to solve our own problems. Instead of always running downtown to the white man, telling him what's wrong, and begging him for his crumbs, we wanted to get together here in Harlem and analyze our own problems. And see what we could do ourselves to solve our problems. Because as long as we sit around here waiting for some blue-eyed white man to undo what he himself is guilty of doing, we'll be another 1,000 years waiting for a solution to the race problem. Our problem has to be solved by us. We have to do it ourselves. Our condition has to be corrected ourselves. No white man can do it for us. No white man will do it for us. No white man wants to do it for us. No white man even has the nature to do it for us. So, we sent them the letter, pointing out to them that if capitalistic Kennedy and communistic Khrushchev can find something in common on which the former United White Front despite their tremendous ideological differences, that it's time for the so-called Negro leaders to submerge all of our trivial, minor differences in order to seek a common solution to a common problem posed by a common enemy to our people by forming a united black front. If the American government, which is a white government, and the Russian government, which is a white government, can get together and form a united white front, and that's all they form, a united white front, then it is time for you and me, time for us, to forget our little differences and in some way try to find how we can form a united black front. When you see the white man forming a united white front, he's forming that front against a common enemy, an enemy that's a common enemy to them. And their enemy is not considered by them as white. Likewise with us. When you see you and I getting together, it is because we have begun to realize that we have a common enemy. And the only time we'll be able to come together with a common objective and a common goal is when we first develop a common motive. And that motive is best developed by recognizing the common enemy. And that common enemy is the white man. I say that common enemy is the white man. The white man is your enemy, whether you are a Baptist, whether you are a Methodist, whether you are an Episcopalian, or whether you're a Muslim, or whether you're a Mason, or whether you're an elk. If you find yourself running into opposition when you're looking for freedom, justice, and equality, or some kind of right, you have to agree always the one who opposes your right is the white man. Some old blue-eyed, blonde-haired, bad-smelling white man. And he doesn't like you any better than he likes me. Some of you are dumb enough to think that he makes a distinction, that he makes a difference. But in his eyesight, there's no difference. When he puts his club upside your head, he doesn't care whether you're a Baptist, a Methodist, but he does want to know whether or not you're a Muslim. Because he knows if you're a Baptist or a Methodist, you're going to turn the other cheek. You're going to try and love your enemy. You're going to pray for them that they're fightfully use you. So he's not worried about it. But he knows if you're a Muslim, you're not going to turn the other cheek. If you pray for him, you pray that God kills him, or God helps you to kill him. That's the only kind of prayer you pray. So since you and I can realize we're all in the same boat, catching the same hell from the same man, it's time for you and me to unite, to get together, and get this big white ink off our back. You got a bad habit. You're hooked and don't know it. You got what's known as white disease. You think you can't get along without the white man. You think you can't get some clothes without the white man. You think you can't get a house without the white man. You think you can't even get a job without the white man. You're worse than a man who thinks he can't get along without heroin. You're worse than the man who thinks he can't get along without morphine. You're worse than the junkie. You're in worse shape than the junkie because the junkie only has a little monkey on his back and you're running around with a big white ink named Uncle Sam on your back. So I wrote a letter inviting Dr. King and Dr. Bunch and the others to come out to this unity rally. I have a card here from Dr. King's secretary saying, "Dear Mr. X, Dr. King is out of the city at this time and will be away for about 2 weeks. Your letter of recent date will be brought to his attention for reply immediately on his return to Atlanta. We are happy to hear from Dr. King." Also, we had another reply from James Farmer, who said, "Dear Minister Malcolm, thank you very much for your kind invitation to participate in the rally you are sponsoring Saturday, August 10th. We are in wholehearted agreement with your views that Negroes struggling for equal rights must not allow themselves to be divided. I deeply regret that a previous commitment forces me to be in Los Angeles on that day, and it will, therefore, be impossible for me to address your rally. Please express to the gathered throng the determination of CORE and myself to continue the fight for freedom in our country. We're glad to hear from Dr. Gene Farmer, who's busy out in Los Angeles fighting the blue-eyed white men. That's who he's fighting. Also, we got a letter in this line from Dr. Ralph Bunch, or rather from his secretary. Dear Malcolm X, in the absence of Mr. Bunch, who is in Europe, I acknowledge the receipt of your letter of August the 1st, inviting him to attend a Muslim rally on Saturday, August the 10th, at 116th Street and Lenox Avenue, New York. Unhappily, Mr. Bunch will not be able to attend the rally, since he is not due back in New York until the end of this month. Your letter will, of course, be placed before him at that time. We're happy to hear from Dr. Bunch's secretary. We're sorry that he's tied up in business abroad while there's so much urgent business here in this country. And we do think that if he can settle differences between the opposing factions in the Middle East and in the Congo, he should be able to mediate down in Mississippi or Alabama or maybe here in New York City between you and some of these northern crackers. We also sent a letter to Whitney M. Young, executive director of the Urban League, who said, Dear Minister Malcolm, I appreciate very much your invitation to speak at your rally on Saturday, August the 10th, as well as the general spirit of your remarks, urging the need for cooperation where possible. I deeply regret that a commitment made several months ago will find me out of the city on that date and therefore unable to participate in the rally. All of them busy. Made me feel like that man Jesus was talking about who set a dinner and invited all the big stuff, the lawyers and the doctors and what have you. And they all sent me back a message and said, well, the lawyer said he had a client, the doctor had a patient, the real estate man had too much property. They were all too busy within that seat. So Jesus said to the man, said, well, go out in the alley, in the highway and in the byway and get those people. They're not too busy. They don't have any jobs. Don't have too much home, and they've not looked up to the white man. They don't have to ask his permission if he can come. So they always come out. Another letter from Dean Foreman of SNCC. SNCC is one of the more recently formed civil rights organizations. Dear Malcolm X, thank you for your invitation to attend the rally in New York, August the 10th. Unfortunately, I will be on the West Coast. Couldn't still be in the country and be any farther away than the West Coast. Unfortunately, I will be on the West Coast and will not be able to be present. I would like to have a representative present from SNCC and will forward your invitation to Cortland Cox, a member of our staff who is in New York working on the Washington Watch. You can expect to hear from him. I share your concern for the possible explosion of the present racial crisis. Thank you for this effort at working toward a constructive handling of the tensions. Gene Foreman, Executive Secretary of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. This is a very nice letter from him, and I thank him for taking the time to write, and he did, or at least his representative was supposed to be here today. If he's not here, he will be here. Also, a telegram, well, I read you this letter first, from our brother, Roy Wilson. He wrote the longest letter, and it's a good letter. Dear Minister, I acknowledge your courteous letter of August the 1st with its kind invitation to me to speak at an outdoor rally on Saturday, August 10th, and to give an analysis of the present race problem and the solutions proposed by my organization. I regret that I will not be able to be present because of a commitment on the West Coast for that weekend. All of us here are so occupied with the campaign for the enactment of civil rights legislation in Congress and with the August 28th march in Washington, D.C., that I find no staff member available to respond to your invitation. It is my feeling that the NAACP analysis of the race problem is very well known, and the solution urged by it is also well known, having been publicized continuously for many, many years. I note and appreciate your assurance that this will be a rally for the statement of views and not one for debating, arguing, criticizing, or condemning, and that you as moderator guarantee order and courtesy for all speakers. I repeat that I appreciate this assurance, and in return I wish to state that I have never been apprehensive about appearing at a meeting sponsored by the Muslims. Now, I think this is good for Roy Wilson to say this. I repeat I wish to state that I have never been apprehensive about appearing at a meeting sponsored by the Muslims. For in all my contacts with you and your followers, I have met only courtesy and consideration. This is Roy Wilson. I am afraid I cannot say the same for some outdoor rallies held in New York City and Harlem and elsewhere, in which the Muslims were not the sponsors and not responsible for order. It happens that my schedule of out-of-town trips is so heavy throughout the year that I have not been able to be present at Muslim-sponsored rallies, but I wish to assure you that my absence is in no sense due to any fear that the host Muslim will be anything except fair and hospitable. Very sincerely, yours, Roy Wilson. That's Brother Roy. I think it's nice of him to say that. And when a lot of these white liberals hear that he said it, they're going to get on me. If they are, they're going to start calling him Roy X. Here's the last reply we received from A. Philip Randolph. Our wire greatly regrets that a previous long-standing commitment prevents my participation in your meeting Saturday, August the 10th. A. Philip Randolph. We're very happy to hear from him, too. We know he's busy. He's the one who's supposed to be over this march that the so-called Negroes are supposed to be making on Washington in a couple of weeks. And they're all of the civil rights leaders are very wrapped up in that march, in preparation for that march. And I think that most of the administration and people in Washington are greatly concerned. They would be more concerned if they didn't think they had everything under control. Where's that cartoon? Bring it around here, brother. An artist's conception of the march. It points out how, when the masses of black people originally stated that they were going to march on Washington, the government was shook up. It was afraid all of the senators and the congressmen and the president, everybody down there. They said, we don't want all the Negroes coming down here. They'll explode. And they got all the Negro leaders in to try and stop the march. You probably read about it, trying to get them to call it off. And the Negro leaders began to tell them, we can't call this thing off. These are our people that are stirred up. They're about to explode. If you don't let them blow you up, they'll blow us up. Why, some of the preachers were talking about going out to Idlewild Airport and sitting on the runway so the planes couldn't land, and driving out here on the parkway and blocking up the welfare and construction. They were talking way out of their head. And the white man was shook up. And when he found out that he couldn't stop it, he joined it. That's what he always does. When he can't stop you, he joins you. And when he joins you, you're not going to go in the same direction you originally were headed in. So they put out, I think, $800,000 to give these Negroes. $800,000, that's more than a $500,000 to help finance the march on Washington. And promised them, I think, $700 million more after it was all over. This is not a secret. Everybody's talking about this. This is what they actually did. And then after they felt down there that they had everything under control, the man you see sitting in that chair over there, he said, come on, I think all you Negroes should come. So he figured he had everything under control. And they think right now they got that thing under control. But you can't control any 100,000 black people nowadays. You can't find 100 non-violent black people. And you can't find 100 people who still love the white man. Not anymore. Our people are waking up. There'll be no skullduggery, no flim-flam, no compromise, no sellout, no controlled show, no false show. No, we need either this or that. This or that. If you're wrong, you're wrong, and if you're right, you're right. And if the people down there are right, they don't have anything to worry about. But if they're wrong, they should be worrying. Because God is against ugly. God doesn't like ugly. When you get real ugly, God chastises. And he chastises you in a way that you least expect it. If he doesn't strike you, he'll strike your children.
Right.
He'll strike at you through the ones you love the most. He'll make your babies be born dead. And it will serve you right. Rally here today with a few introductory remarks before bringing forth those of our speakers who have showed up. America is faced with her greatest crisis since the Civil War. Wherever we look today, whether it's south, north, east, or west, we see increasing race tension. We see the increase of racial animosity, racial hostility, and outright racial hatred. We see masses of black people who have lost all confidence in the false promises of hypocritical white politicians. We see masses of black people who are thoroughly set up with the deceit of white so-called liberals. White liberals who have posed as our friends. White liberals who have been eager to point out what the white man in the South has been doing to us while they themselves here in the North are doing the same thing. They have been making a great fuss over the South only to blind us to what is happening here in the North. And now that the eyes of America's 20 million blacks can easily see that this white fox here in the North is even more cruel and vicious than the white wolf in the South. The Southern wolves always let you know where you stand. But these Northern foxes, pulled as white liberals, they pulled as your friend, pulled as your benefactor, pulled as your employer, they pulled as your landlord, they pulled as the neighborhood merchant, they pulled as your lawyer trying to help you. They infiltrate all your organizations, and in this manner, by joining you, they strangle your militant efforts toward freedom, toward justice, and toward equality. They use integration for infiltration. Throughout America, here in the North as well as the South, masses of black people are demonstrating against the oppression and exploitation of the white man. Our people have lost all fear of the white man. They have ceased trying to waste their love on the white man. And they have ceased turning their nonviolent cheek to the violent white man. And because of this new, fearless, more militant attitude on the part of our people, we see the increase of violence and bloodshed between the white oppressor and the oppressed, between the white they exploit, between the white slave master and his 20 million ex-slaves. And where will all of this end? America is faced with her worst domestic crisis since the Civil War, or since the Revolutionary War. For America now faces a race war. A race war is worse than a Revolutionary War. A race war is worse than a Civil War. A race war is a war in which no holds are barred. A race war is a war in which children are destroyed, in which children are mutilated, in which children face the same destructive wrath that grown-ups face. A race war is the worst war that you can conceive. And this war, race war, that is coming upon the head of the white man is something that he is bringing down upon himself. The entire country is on the verge of erupting into racial violence and bloodshed. Simply because 20 million ex-slaves are demanding freedom, justice, and equality here in America from their former slave master. 20 million so-called Negroes, second-class citizens, seeking human dignity, seeking human rights, seeking the right to live in dignity as a human being. And rather than give genuine respect and recognition to your cry for human rights, the American white man answers your nonviolence with violence. He answers your prayers and your freedom songs with false promises, deceitful maneuvers, and outright bloodshed. According to what we are taught from the white man's textbooks and his school, the Revolutionary War and the Civil War were two wars fought on American soil, supposedly for freedom and democracy. But if these two wars were really for the freedom and human dignity of all men, why are 20 million of our people still confined here in America and enslaved by second-class citizenship? Something is wrong. The truth is that the Revolutionary War was fought on American soil to free the American white man from the English white man. The Revolutionary War was never fought to provide freedom and democracy in this white country for the black man. Our people remain slaves here in America even after the Declaration of Independence was signed. In fact, most of the white founding fathers who signed the Declaration of Independence were nothing but slave owners themselves. It is sheer hypocrisy, sheer ignorance, sheer insanity for our people here in America to celebrate the 4th of July as Independence Day, while white America still denies us first-class citizenship that goes with an independent people. And it is nothing but hypocrisy for the American white man to pretend that the Revolutionary War was truly a war of independence as long as 20 million black people here in America are denied the privileges of an independent people. Don't let the white man fool you. Don't let the white man smile at you and lull you to sleep. Behind that smile is a vicious heart. Behind those teeth is an animal-like beast who doesn't have it within him to want for you what he wants for himself and his own kind. Don't let that man fool you. When you look at that man, you're supposed to see him for exactly what he is. And if you want to know what he is, examine his deeds. Forget his words. He got a whole lot of pretty sounding words. Watch his deeds. His deeds are like the deeds of a snake, the deeds of a serpent, the deeds of a dragon, the deeds of a reptile, the deeds of a beast. Why, nothing but a race of beasts would take dogs and stick them on little black babies. Nothing but a race of beasts will stick dogs on black children and black women. Nothing but a race of beasts. And it is these deeds today that's causing the wrath of God to come down upon the head of the white man. And when you see him as he is and see how much hell he's catching, you're out of his mind to want to be with him. You're out of your mind to want to integrate with him. And you're really out of your mind if you take time to forgive him and ask God to have mercy on him. No, ask God to judge him. Ask God to do unto him as he has done unto you. He has caused your babies to suffer. Ask God to heap suffering upon his babies. He has caused your women to suffer. Ask God to heap suffering on his women. He has caused all of our people to suffer. You can't deny that. You may not like my saying it, but you can't deny it. Why, you got scars and knots on your head from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet. And every one of those scars is evidence against the American white man and his inhumanity to man. The Civil War was also fought on this continent. Not to free the black slave, as is commonly taught in the white man's school, but the Civil War was actually fought to preserve the Union, preserve this country, keep it intact for white people. It wasn't fought to set you free. It wasn't fought to give you some kind of emancipation. It wasn't fought to make you a citizen. It wasn't fought to give you civil rights. It wasn't fought because they respected you and loved you as a human being. It was fought out of greed. It was fought out of selfishness. It was fought to keep this country intact for their own white selves. In essence, this only means that the American white man fought the Revolutionary War to get this country for himself. And he then fought the Civil War to keep this country intact for himself. And today, he will now fight a race war to keep from having to share this white country on an equal basis with anyone else but his white self, especially on an equal basis with his 20 million former slaves. So again I ask, where will all of these demonstrations end? And who dares to say that our people are not justified by demonstrating their resentment over the injustice and mistreatment that our people have suffered these 400 years at the hands of this cruel, inhuman American white man? We have nothing to lose but our change. We have nothing to lose but the hell we experience every day living here in these rat-filled slums. And as I mentioned at our rally a couple of weeks ago, the worst housing conditions in every city in America always exist in the so-called Negro community. Yet the white liberals who own these rundown houses force us to pay the highest rent. And that's who owns these houses. White liberals, your white friend, your white benefactor, your white buddy who joined your integrated organization. That's the white man who's your landlord. That's the white man who is choking you and routing you and exploiting you. That blue-eyed thing that walks around here in Harlem collecting rent. trying to pat you on the back and tell you how much progress you're making when you're catching more hell today than your grandfather caught 100 years ago. Yes, excuse me for being blunt-speaking and frank talking. We don't care who likes it or not, as long as we know it's the truth. Much of what I say might sound bitter, but it's the truth. Much of what I say might sound like it's stirring up trouble, but it's the truth. Much of what I say might sound like it is hate, but it's the truth. And God has mentioned in the Bible, it's truth alone today that'll make you free. If you're afraid to tell the truth, why, you don't even deserve freedom. Just tell the truth. The best thing to put the white man to flight is truth. He can't take the truth. He can't stand the truth. He doesn't like the truth, especially when you know the truth about him. The truth about how he got those blue eyes. And the truth about how he got that strange dog-like hair. And the truth about how his skin became as pale and pallid and speckly as it is. When you know the truth about how he got the way he is, you can run him down the street with nothing but truth. You don't need any blade. You don't need any switchblade. All you need is the truth. They put you in jail for carrying a blade, but they can't put you in jail for telling the truth. Here in Harlem, we have the worst homes that pay the highest rent. And faced with this high overhead, we are forced to take in roomers in order to help us pay our rent. Y'all experience that every day. You rent one of these old rundown apartments here in Harlem, but from the white man. He charges so much rent for that apartment, you got to rent part of it out in order to get some of your money back. So what happens? Our apartments become filled with relatives, with strangers. Our community becomes overcrowded, and these overcrowded conditions under which our people are forced to live eliminates all chance for a normal home, for a clean home, or for a healthy home. Your home quick soon becomes filled with cockroaches and rats who live better than you do. And because our children are forced to grow up in this overcrowded atmosphere, the lack of much-needed privacy destroys their sense of shame. It lowers their moral standards and leaves them exposed to every form of indecency and vice that is running rampant in the community. Our young girls, our daughters, our baby sisters become unwed mothers before they are hardly in their teens. 12 years old, 11 years old, 13 years old, running around here with babies. Our community has thousands of unmarried mothers, mothers who have no hope of ever getting a husband. All they can get is another baby, and another baby, and another baby, but never a husband. And because of this, our community has tens of thousands of little black babies who have no father to act as their protector or their provider. As it was mentioned in the last rally, the only provider many of our children know is the white welfare agent or the white social worker. And because of this, many of our children mistake the white welfare agent worker as their father. And sometimes they're right. You see all these little half-white babies running around in the community. They're not that way because you and I want them to be that way. The white man rapes and ravages and takes advantage of our women. He'll take your little sister. Yes, he will. Your little baby sister is the potential bait for every white man in Harlem. Your little daughter, your mother, your wife. Ask them sometimes. Every time they walk past the white man, he hits on them. He thinks that they're animals, that he can abuse at will. This is where you get all these little half-white babies running around the street. None of them know who their daddy is. And all of them think that the white man is their daddy. And as I said, most of them are right. And if you and I, if we don't wake up and keep that white man away from our women, our race will really be destroyed. Keep that white man's claws off our women. Make him know that the best way, yes. I never would stand up to an audience as large as this and fail to warn you of the importance of protecting your own woman. You can't go in a white neighborhood and get a white woman. You can't get the white man's daughter
or his sister in his neighborhood? Then why did you let him walk around here in your neighborhood with your wife and your mother and your daughter and your sister? If you do it to him, he'll bust your head. And what's good for the goose is good for the gander. Remember that. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. Do you understand what I'm saying? What's good for the goose is good for the gander. Let him know that the price he'll have to pay when he taps your woman is either the loss of his hand or the loss of his arm or the loss of his head. And if you go to jail for taking his head, you went to jail for a good cause. You can go to prison and say, I came here because I defended our black women from the filthy paws of that blue-eyed white man. Yes, I'm saying it and I mean it. You can go in hotels around here and find these white men laying up there with black women. Why, you could snatch off their heads. I mean, snatch off their heads. You and I will never be respected until we get some respect for this black woman. Make her straighten up, and then straighten out that white man. And there's nothing wrong with that. No, what I'm telling you is not wrong. I'm telling you what is right. If he respects his women, then it's respect ours. And if he'll hang you for molesting his woman, you got your right to hang him for molesting your woman. Here in the state of New York, they have a state institution, penal institution for women. 70% of the women in the state prison institution, black women, 70% of the women in that prison, our women, the average age, 24 years old. Why, good God, man, what's happening to your woman? They're making her a prostitute. They're making her a drug addict. They're making her a lesbian. They're making her a harlot. They're making her a solid. Because you and I won't stand up and be men. A man, when you're a man, you're not afraid to go to jail. When you're a man, you're not afraid to give your life. And when you're a man, you're not afraid to take someone else's life. You believe in a fair exchange. The overcrowded homes of our community force us to live under some of the worst sanitary conditions imaginable. It becomes almost impossible here in Harlem to practice the rules of good hygiene. Therefore, tuberculosis, TB, syphilis, gonorrhea, and other destructive social diseases are destroying the health and the moral fiber of our community. Our people here in Harlem are trapped in a vicious cycle of ignorance, poverty, disease, sickness, and death. And there seems no way out. There seems to be no way of escape. And the wealthy, educated, black bourgeoisie, the upper-class Negroes, those who do escape, they never reach back and pull the rest of us out along with them. They move up in Westchester with their white friends, with their white liberals, or up in Stamford, Connecticut. The black masses remain trapped here in the slums. And because there seems no hope or no other way out, no other escape, we turn to wine as a way out. We turn to whiskey as a way out. We turn to reefers as a way out. And many of our people here in Harlem, and especially right here in this neighborhood, have turned to that dreadful needle. Heroin, morphine, cocaine, opium, poison, nothing but poison. But you turn to it seeking an escape from the misery that the brutality and the deceit of the white man has trapped us in here in Harlem. That's the only way you know of escape.
many of our people turn to crime. Stealing, gambling, prostitution, organized crime. Crime that has been organized here in Harlem by the white man. You don't organize any crime. He organizes the crime. He controls the prostitution in Harlem. He controls the numbers racket in Harlem. He controls the drug traffic in Harlem. He is the one that controls it. He is the master criminal. He is the arch enemy. He gets you drunk and then locks you up for being drunk. He sells you whiskey and then locks you up when he catches you drunk. He sells you a deck of cards and locks you up when he catches you using them. While you are dealing with nothing but a deceitful, blue-eyed devil walking around here on this earth over to hell as long as you follow him. I hope I don't frighten him. When many of us turn to crime, and I had plenty of experience of it right out here in Harlem, I know what it's all about. Stealing, gambling, and prostitution, we allow ourselves to be used by the white overlords downtown to bring their dope back up here in Harlem and push it among our poor, innocent, unsuspecting young people. Why, we let the white man use us to make drug addicts out of children, to make drug addicts out of babies, drug addicts out of mothers. We let the white man use us to bring that poison up here in Harlem and stick it into the veins of our people. You take it downtown and give it to some white people and see how long you walk the street as a few men, free men. No, the only time he'll let you get away with it is when you're giving it to your own kind, when you're poisoning your own kind, making your own kind high and making your own kind drunk. I know what I'm talking about. I used to be used by that blue-eyed white man for the same thing. I know it. He's the one behind it, and he knows that I know it and can't say anything about it because he knows that I know it. You can't get dope in Harlem without the white man's permission. You can't play numbers in Harlem without the white man's permission. You can't open up a gambling house in Harlem without the white man's permission. Why, you can't even be a prostitute without the white man's permission. And then when he makes you these things, he turns around and talks about them. All of them get drunk. That's what he says. All of them are winos. That's what he says. All of them are delinquents. That's what he says. Why, he breaks your wings and then calls you a cripple. He breaks your legs and then calls you a cripple. He puts out your eyes and then accuses you of not being able to see. You're dealing with nothing but a walking, talking, blue-eyed devil. And the day you realize it, you won't look to him for any solution for your problem. You know, they call this hate teaching. This is not hate teaching. This is love teaching.
Right.
If I didn't love you, I wouldn't tell you what I'm telling you.
That's right.
I wouldn't stick my neck out. I wouldn't take a chance.
Yeah.
Why, don't you know that old blue-eyed thing stands around here just waiting for me to say something that he can put me in jail? I make sure that everything I say is the truth, the gospel truth. And once I know it's the truth, I'm going to tell it if it costs me my life. So this isn't hate teaching. This is love teaching. This is love talk. We love you, but we don't love him. We want to unite with you, but we don't want to unite with him. We recognize you as our brother, but we don't recognize that old blue-eyed thing as our brother. Let him go on and be a brother to himself. Unemployment and poverty has forced many of our people into this life of crime. But as we pointed out a couple of weeks ago, the real criminal is in City Hall downtown. The real criminal is in the State House in Albany. The real criminal is in the White House in Washington, D.C. The real criminal is the white man who poses as a liberal, the political hypocrite. And it is these legal crooks posing as our friends, forcing us into a life of crime, and then using us to spread the white man's evils and vices among our own people. Our people are scientifically maneuvered by the white man into a life of poverty. You're not poor accidentally. He maneuvers you into poverty. You're not ignorant accidentally. He maneuvers you into ignorance. You're not a drug addict accidentally. Why, this white man maneuvers you into drug addiction. You're not a prostitute accidentally. You have been maneuvered into prostitution by the American. There is nothing about your condition here in America that is an accident. It is part of the scientific method used by the American white man to keep us here in bondage, in ignorance, in poverty, 20th century slavery. Because we are forced to live in the poorest section of the city, we attend inferior schools. We have inferior teachers. We get an inferior education. The white power structure downtown makes certain that by the time you and I do graduate, we won't be equipped or qualified for anything but the dirtiest, heaviest, poorest paying jobs, jobs that no one else wants. They prepare us for this. We are trapped in a vicious cycle of debt. Inferior jobs, inferior housing, inferior education, which again leads to inferior jobs. We spend a lifetime in this vicious cycle, going in circles, giving birth to children who see no hope or future but to follow in the miserable footsteps of their poverty-stricken parents. We saw no solution to our problem. We saw no real leader among our people. But today the whole world is talking, they're talking about the divine solution that he has received from the God of our forefathers. Not a temporary solution which will benefit only the handpicked upper class Negroes, but a solution divinely designed to solve the plight of the black masses permanently and forever. But the government does not want our people to listen and understand the solution that God has given, because the government is against God. I say the government is against God. In order to trick our people away from God's true solution, the government is trying to deceive you with a false solution, a phony solution, a deceitful solution called token integration. Don't you know, tokenism is a drag. You go to the subway for a token. Is that token money? No. It's a substitute for money. It's not the real thing. It's a substitute. It's a pacifier. When your baby starts crying at home because it's hungry, and you don't want to give your baby any milk, what do you give it? A pacifier. A substitute, tokenism. And that's the same thing that this blue-eyed white man is tricking you and me with today. He hears you crying out like a baby for freedom and justice and equality. And knowing that he can't give it to you, he sticks a pacifier in your mouth. He gives you tokenism, little crumbs. He sticks a couple of Negroes in the University of Mississippi and tells you it's integrated. And a couple more in the University of Alabama and tells you it's integrated. And another one in the University of South Carolina and tells you that that's integrated. That's nothing but tokenism. It's nothing but deceit. It's nothing but false maneuvering. And God is going to bring chastisement upon the American white man for tricking the so-called Negroes here in this country. God is after him. God is not only after him for enslaving you. God is after him for tricking you, for deceiving you. God is after him. God is the one that's making his ship sink in the sea. God is the one who brings his airplane crashing out of the sky full of white folks.
God is the one that makes his cars crack up on the highway. God is the one that's given polio to his little children and making his senators die with heart attacks. That's the work of God. That's a blessing from God. That's the reward that God has given him for the evil that he has done. That's a wicked race. And God is making his children be born today, be formed, cemented, or dead. That's from God. That's what God did to Pharaoh. When Pharaoh wouldn't treat those people right, and Pharaoh wasn't stopped by those other plagues, God began to strike the firstborn. God began to knock off his children. God began to devils lose their children. And when they saw their own little babies dying, and their senators dying, and their congressmen dying, and their former presidents dying, and their big shots falling out, then they knew that there was a God trying to separate those people from that wicked slave master. And just as it was in those days, it's the same way today. It isn't you who's after the white man. God is after the white man. It isn't cunningness that's after the white man. God is after the white man. God doesn't love ugly, and there's nothing on this earth uglier than that blue-eyed, string-haired, bad-smelling race of devil.
The Negro leadership demanded the white man's house.
and the whites vacated their rundown houses for us and built new homes for themselves out in the suburbs. Then the Negro leadership demanded seats for our children in the white man's school. The whites evacuated the school as our children moved in, and they built modern schools for themselves out in the suburbs. But now the Negro leadership is demanding the white man's job. Can the whites vacate their jobs like they vacated their homes and their schools? Not without violence and bloodshed. The same white liberals who used to praise you for your patient, nonviolent approach have now become openly impatient and violent themselves in defense of their own job. Not only in the South, but also in the North, right here in New York City. Why, they were busting heads out in Brooklyn. They were busting heads out in Long Island. They were busting heads up in the Bronx. White teenagers came out in sheets. Ku Klux Klan, not in Georgia, but right up there in, not down south, but down in the Bronx. White teenagers came out there burning cars to let you know that this white man here is no different from that white man down there. White Nazis, not in Germany, right here in New York City, up there burning crosses, had a carload of guns ready to come at you like they came at the Jews over in Germany. And when they caught those Nazis, they found that one of them was a Jew. And that Jew went around here talking about Nazis, but never nothing but Nazis themselves. You didn't hear them blow that up in the newspaper, did you? No, they tried to quiet it down. Why, when you find Jews who are Nazis, you really found something. In fact, I think you can find a whole lot of them who are Nazis. Always running around here trying to make you get sympathetic for them. But you are the master at that. Make you shed crocodile tears over what happened to him in Germany. You tell him what happened to you right here. You haven't got no time to cry no tears for no Jews. Cry tears for yourself. Let him solve his problem and you solve your problem. Why, they only killed 6 million Jews. Only 6 million Jews were killed by Hitler. Uncle Sam killed 100 million black people bringing them here. Yeah? 100 million. 100 million. Don't let no Jew get up in your face and make you cry for him. Ask him what happened with his forefathers when our forefathers were being brought over here as slaves. 100 million black people were taken from Africa. And when the Civil War was over, there weren't 6 million black people in America. There weren't 20 million black people in the Western Hemisphere. What happened to 80 million? Where did they go? Where did they disappear? Why, that dog dropped them in the water and worked them to death. He murdered them. He butchered them. He mutilated them. I mean 80 million of your and my forefathers. And you think that God is going to forgive him for that? No. You might be dumb enough to forgive him for it, but God won't forgive him for it. That's why God is after him. 80 million black people, dead, murdered. And these Jews got the audacity to run around here and want you to cry for them. Let them go cry for themselves. Tell them if they're interested in your problem that you have some of these stores. Instead of opening stores up all in your neighborhood and robbing your deaf, dumb, and blind. You ask the Jews to do that. And some of them blue-eyed Jews are going to walk away from here and say that I'm saying something anti-Semitic. Anti-hell. That get you drunk. It is Jews that run these old run-down stores that sell you bad food. It is Jews who control the economy of Holland and use it for themselves and for the benefit of Israel. And got dumb enough to walk around here some NAACP or CORE and think we're going to be blind to what they're doing to us. No, someone better pull their coat. Someone better pull their coat. shot bullets and heads. That's not anti-Semitic. That's just plain intelligence. You know, I was on a program here in New York on Channel 13, in which I made a statement concerning how the Jews control about 80% of the economy in most Negro communities across the country. And the Jews organized themselves and wouldn't let that thing come back on Channel 13. It was two interviews. One was done by Baldwin and one was done by me. The one I did two. One was short and one was a 30-minute duration. And at the end of it, you remember Morgenthau jumped up and said that he's not responsible for anything I said. Well, I can understand why he said that, because during that same week, these same old so-called liberal Jews who claim they believe in free speech and all that old kind of stuff, they got together and prevented the showing of that interview again, simply because I had made the statement. That the Jews are the ones who are rousing us and exploiting us up here in Harlem and across the country. The Jews believe in censorship more than anybody else. All you got to do is start talking about Jews, and you'll find all the papers will close up on you. They can't take it. They can't take any criticism. They're the most sensitive white people on this earth. They don't like you to talk about them, but they want to talk about everybody else. They want to tell you what Hitler and Eichmann did to them, but don't want us to tell you what Uncle Sam has done to us. And Hitler didn't kill as many of them as Uncle Sam has killed those of us. And if they were justified in snatching Eichmann and taking him back over there and gassing him, then God has justified grabbing Uncle Sam and putting the gas to him. See, they set themselves up as judge and high lord executioner. Well, we're not doing that. We're leaving the judgment and the justice up to God. So, brothers and sisters, your present demand today here in America for more of the white man's jobs, which are already scarce, can lead to nothing but violence and bloodshed. It may even lead to a race war. A bloody race war. And it is the government itself that is now pressing the people of this country into a racial bloodbath. Government policy is doing nothing but instigating the two races toward nothing but a clash, a racial bloodbath. But what white people in this country should be made to understand, this is a new day. And our people, this generation, is a new people. That old Uncle Tom type Negro is dead. He's gone. Tom is gone. Our people have no more fear of anyone. They have no more fear of anything. We're not afraid to go to jail. We're not afraid to give our very life itself. And what's most important, we're not afraid to take the life of those who try and take our life. Did you hear what I said? This is the basic difference between this generation and former generations. We'll give our life just like that. But not only will we give it, we'll take the life of the one who's trying to take our life. We believe in a fair exchange. We believe in an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth, and a head for a head, and a life for a life. That's justice. There's nothing wrong with that. An eye for an eye, and tooth for a tooth, and an arm for an arm, and a head for a head, and a life for a life. When you have that kind of philosophy, no one will put his hands on you. You walk around here, keep turning and enemy loving, while you'll have knots on your body from the top of your head to the sole of your feet. If the white man doesn't turn his other cheek, you don't need to turn your other cheek. If the white man doesn't learn to love his enemy, you don't need to love your enemy. If the white man doesn't give up his life easily, you don't need to give up your life easily. If it's hard to take his life, it should be hard for him to take your life. That's justice. Why, his Bible even says, he who kills with the sword will be killed by the sword. That's what his Bible says in the 13th chapter of Revelation in his Bible. He who leaves into captivity will go into captivity. That's justice. How you gonna make a man a slave and think you're too good to be made a slave? Why, if the Bible is right, then the white man has to go into slavery. If the Bible is right, then the white man has to be lynched. If the Bible is right, the white man has to be made to suffer the same things that our people have suffered. It's justice. And if this is the price of freedom, we won't hesitate to pay that price. By trying to oppose the divine solution that God has given to the American government will actually provoke another civil war. And by that I mean, this government will provoke a civil war among white people by trying to force white people to give their jobs to our people. And our people will provoke a race war by trying to make white people give up their jobs. Don't you mislead yourself. If the government tries to force them to give us jobs, the government's going to have a civil war. And if you try and force them to give up their jobs, you're going to make up a race war. These are facts. Our idiots can see through these. This racial dilemma poses a serious problem for white America. Civil war between white people on the one hand, and a race war between the whites and their 20 million ex-slaves on the other hand. And the entire dark world is watching, waiting to see what the American government will do to solve this problem once and for all. We must have a permanent solution. A temporary solution won't do. 20 million ex-slaves must be permanently separated from our former slave masters and placed on some land that we can call our own. And then we can create our own jobs. Then we can control our own economy. And then we can solve our own problems instead of waiting for the American white man to solve our problems for us. On our own land, we can set up farms. On our own land, we can set up factories. On our own land, we can set up businesses. We can establish our own government and become an independent nation. And once we become separated from the jurisdiction of this white nation, we can then enter into trade and commerce for ourselves with other independent nations. This is the only solution. We must be an independent nation. We now number 20 million black people, a nation within a nation, a black nation within a white nation, crying to be born, clearing to be set free, and let us go our way. If he doesn't love us, we sure don't love him. And if he doesn't want us, we sure don't want him. In our own land, we can establish our own agricultural system. We can farm. We can grow food to feed our own people. We can raise cattle. We can use the hide, the leather, the wool to make clothing for our own people. We can dig the clay from the earth and bake it into bricks and build houses and homes for our people. We can chop down trees and turn it into lumber and build furniture and furnish homes for our people. When I was in Africa, I saw Africans making their own furniture. I mean modern furniture, up-to-date furniture, sharp furniture. They over there making their own. You over here begging Goldberg for his. A dollar down and a dollar when I catch you. And Goldberg always catches you. If Goldberg can't catch you, Goldstein will catch you. And if Goldstein don't catch you, Greenberg will catch you. A dollar down and a dollar later, and later is always now. When we have our own land, we can dig the natural resources from the earth. Land is the basis of all economic security. Land to freedom, justice, and equality. Land is essential to true independence. Africans aren't asking for integration. They're asking for land. In Kenya, they told the white man to get out. Uganda, they told the white man to get out. Tanganyika, they told the white man to get out. In Guinea, they told the white man to get out. In Egypt, they told the white man to get out. In Morocco and Algeria, they told the white man to get out. In the Congo, Lumumba told the white man to get out. And in southern Rhodesia, they're telling the white man to get out. In northern Rhodesia, they're telling the white man to get out. In Angola, they're telling the white man to get out. white man to get out. In Southwest Africa, they're telling the white man to get out. In Mozambique, they're telling the white man to get out. And in South Africa, they're telling the white man to get out. And he says he's not going, but he got another thought coming. He's going. He'll either walk out or swim out in his own blood. He'll walk out of his own volition, or he'll swim out in his own blood. Because the black man has awakened, and the black man has united. And where there's unity, there's strength. You don't need any guns. You just need some unity and a blade when it gets dark. You don't need any jets. You don't need any atomic bombs. You don't need any battleships. All you need is darkness. You need nightfall. That's how Jesus said he was coming, without observation. He's going to sneak up on you. So be like Jesus. Sneak up on them. Wait till it gets dark. Wait till they can't see you, so they don't recognize you and won't know you. And then introduce yourself to them. They did unto you. That's fair. That's justice. That's equality. That's how you equalize the situation. I know they don't want to hear me say that. But I'm telling you the truth. A white man drafts you into his army and trains you how to fight his enemy. Well, that's what you're supposed to do. Fight an enemy. I don't blame him for doing that. But you're also supposed to know how to fight your enemy. And you fight your enemy just like he fights his enemy. You don't spare no blows. You don't spare no quarter. He doesn't spare any quarter. He's not merciful. He dropped a bomb on Hiroshima. 80-some thousand people died just like this. He didn't care. Women and children, he didn't care. They were his enemy. No prayer, no mercy, no nothing. He just wiped them out. You can learn a lot from the white man. We must be separated from the American white man and return to our own land and our own people. This is the only solution. But just as the biblical government of Egypt under Pharaoh was against Moses, because Moses had been directed by God to separate the Hebrew slaves from Pharaoh and lead them out of the house of bondage to a land of their own. Today, this modern house of bondage, America, under the authority of the American government, opposes the effort to separate us from the people here who made us their slaves and lead us to a land of our own. This government opposes the effort to wake our people up. The government opposes efforts to clean our people up. And the government opposes efforts to stand our people on our own feet so we can walk out of this house of bondage to our own land and to our own people. And just as the government of biblical Egypt was against the God of the Hebrew slaves, today the American government is against the God of the Negro slaves. And just as that Pharaoh tried to trick the Hebrew slaves into rejecting the offers of salvation from their God, by deceiving them with false promises through magicians whom he had hired, who were carefully staging demonstrations to fool the people. Today, this government is paying certain elements to deceive you, to deceive us, into thinking that we're going to be accepted into the mainstream of American life. You will never be accepted into the mainstream of American life. You will never get equality in America from the white man. You will never get justice in America from the white man. You
will never get freedom in America from the white man. You will never be accepted in America by the American white man as a human being. The government is deceiving you with false promises, so you won't want to return to your own land and your own people. The government propagandists are telling you, stay here. Don't listen. And if you don't listen, they tell you they'll desegregate the lunch counter. If you don't listen, they'll desegregate the theater. If you don't listen, they'll desegregate the park or desegregate the public toilet. Imagine that, Carl. If you don't listen, you'll have a chance to go to the toilet with white folks. Why, you're out of your mind. Only way I want to go through the toilet with him is to put him down with the rest of that stuff. Flush him right down the drain with the rest of his kind. They tell you that if you don't listen, we'll give you more civil rights bills. You hear the difference? Civil rights bills. They're going to give you another bill and another bill and another bill, and if all you get is the bill. The government promises you this only to keep you from listening and to stop you from waking up. They know that if you listen long enough, you'll begin to do your own thinking. Speak for yourself. Make you able to hear for yourself. Make you able to think for yourself. And make you able to speak for yourself. And sure will make you able and willing and ready to fight for yourself. Whenever you have become fed up with the white man's brutality, and you get set to take matters into your own hands in order to defend your own people, this same hypocritical government tries to pacify you with deceitful promises of tricky civil rights legislation that is never designed as a true solution to your and my problems. Civil rights legislation will never solve our problems. The white liberals are nothing but political hypocrites who use our people as political football, only to get bills passed that will increase their own power. And the present proposed civil rights legislation in Washington, D.C. is designed to do nothing but give the present administration in Washington dictatorial power and make America a legal police state. But it will still never solve our problems. It'll give them power. But still, you and I will be here catching hell. And this is what you must see. The present administration is only using civil rights as a political football to gain more legislation and power for itself. And our people are being used as pawns, political pawns, in the game of power politics by political hypocrites. You can't please the white man. You out there at the downstate Brooklyn Medical Center trying to integrate, and they put you in jail. You can't please him. If you want to get away from you, he condemns you. If you try and cuddle up to him, he condemns you. If you lay down flat on the sidewalk and say, walk on to Mr. White folks, he's still not satisfied. He says, roll over on the other side, nigga. Get over on your back. You just can't please him. You can't satisfy him. Well, you're out of your mind trying to make love to a white man. You're trying to call yourself appealing to his moral conscience. He has no moral conscience. He has no moral. I ain't gonna have moral conscience. He neither has moral nor conscience, much less moral conscience. No, don't waste your time. So the propaganda of the American government is skillfully designed to make our people think they don't want us. The government. This is government propaganda. This is government skullduggery. Yes, I'm telling you what it is. You don't have nothing put in the paper today. That's not government control. Propaganda. They believe in propaganda. Psychological warfare for the mind of man, for your mind, for your body, for your soul, for your allegiance. Propaganda warfare. Propaganda is constantly being put upon you by the newspapers, by the television, by the magazines, by comic books, by everything. Designed to brainwash you into thinking that if you stay here, someday you'll have it made. No, you'll never have it made in this country. To keep you here, the government tells you Africa is a jungle. Isn't that what they say? that Africans are savage, that Africans are backwards. They don't have modern conveniences over there. That's what they tell you. And then they tell you, you're too much like us white folks. What would you do? How would you live if you go back over there? And some of these old dumb, brainwashed, handkerchief-head, 20th century intellectual Negroes, first thing they tell you when you say something about, let's go back home. I haven't lost anything in Africa. No, you lost it all right here. You came over here with it. When you came over here, you had it. But you lost it. You lost your name. You lost your language. You lost your mind. You lost your culture. Don't tell me you didn't lost your mind. You came over here black-minded. Now you're white-minded. Been brainwashed. All of the color has been taken out of your heart and out of your mind. Now you're running around not satisfied unless you can talk like white folks. Unless you can walk like white folks. Unless you can eat and sleep like white folks. You're a white-black man. White on the inside and black on the outside. You're not this and you're not that. Mr. In Between. And don't nobody want you, because you don't want yourself. Why, the book says, don't mess with Mr. In Between. Nobody want Mr. In Between. You're a middleman. They won't let you be white and you don't want to be black. You don't want to be an African and you can't be an American. So you run around here like a nut, like a nut on the law, sitting on the bench. You're in bad shape. Imagine the white man telling you and me that Africa is a jungle, and everything over there is backwards. And if you go over there, you won't like the living conditions. How are they living over there? Why, we got to fight them over there to get them out. If there's no well over there, why don't they get out of there? Why did Lumumba have to fight to get the Belgians out of the Congo? So it's one of the most beautiful places on this earth. If it wasn't beautiful, the white man wouldn't be there. You got the white man all over there. He's everywhere over there, living like a king. But they're getting ready to send him. Send him. No, it's not a jungle. It's civilized. It's cultured. It's developed. It's intelligent. High morals. High everything. Good people. Friendly people. Hospitable people. Brother to a brother. That's how they kidnapped us. We were too hospitable. We saw the old white man coming over the hill, and we accepted him into our city as a friend. And he shipped us down the river, sold us into bondage. This is one of the greatest mistakes that our people made, opening their doors in hospitality to the white man. And when we first saw him coming, we should have sent him then. And we never would have had to catch the hell we've been catching over here in America for the past 400 years. When he came to Africa, he came from the jungle to civilization. Because the jungle was in Europe. Savages were in Europe. Cannibals were in Europe. Cannibals were in Africa. Cannibals were in Europe. White people were up there eating each other up. They still eat each other up. You've seen these berries and things running around here. Those are white people. That's the way they live. They're cannibals. They're savages. They have no morals. A low-down, filthy race. The most filthy race on this earth. They used to live in the cave. They walked on their all fours. They were naked like animals. They couldn't walk upright. They didn't wear clothes. They didn't cook their food. Why, they ate raw meat. They still like their meat rare. Rare? Raw. That's the dog in them, brother. That's the animal in them, brother. Now they're a race of cave dwellers. Didn't know how to bury their dead. For 2,000 years, they lived up in the caves of Europe. And during that time, you and my people were living in luxury, living with high culture, living in a high civilization. Why, Africa is the root of civilization. Africa is the home of civilization. Africa's been civilized a long time. They have all kinds of civilizations in Africa. They have the Egyptian civilization. the Carthaginian civilization, the Mali Empire, the empires of Benin, of Mali, Songhai. Why, you can call out empires all day long from the African continent that were in a high state of culture when these blue-eyed things were crawling around up in Europe, living in huts, eating raw meat. I love to talk about it. I love to talk about it. Yes, I love to talk about it. Talk about them like a dog. And they should be able to take it. Now they know how we feel. Why, when I was a little boy, they called me nigger so much, I thought that was my name. That's all they knew how to call you. Now they get an inkling of how we feel, and the chickens that they sent out there are coming home to roost. They are a race of cave dwellers, raw meat eaters, naked, no clothes wear. That's where they came from. They ain't not fit to be walking around here telling you to look like they do or imitate them. No, they learned civilization from you. They learned culture from you. They learned how to wear clothes from you. They learned how to cook their food from you. They learned mathematics from you. They learned science from you. Why, the black man in Africa had mastered the arts and sciences. Way back yonder, he mastered the mathematical sciences, the astronomical sciences, to the extent where he could plot the course of the stars in the universe when this old white blue-eyed thing didn't even know that the earth was round. He just found out the earth was round.
So if you want to investigate something, find out why they stopped building Harlem Hospital. There were people in Harlem fighting hard for a long time to get that hospital built. Had a hard time getting the white man even to start it. Then when they finally started on it, there's nothing you need in Harlem more than a hospital. Because you're sick, and you just got cut, or you're just getting ready to cut someone else. And we needed that hospital. So all these people had a brainstorm. They got there and picketed and demonstrated, and the white man took away all the workers. That's the work. As someone said earlier this afternoon, they're still being paid and the hospital is not going up. Your money, the money you pay out in taxes, is paying the white construction workers who are sitting at home doing nothing. This is some brainstorm that someone got off the track on when they tried to stop the construction of the hospital in Brooklyn. Couldn't stop it. So their hospital is for white people, primarily, and you are not going to stop. The hospital is for white people, primarily, and you are not going to stop construction where the white man is benefit. The only thing you don't stop is something right here in home. But what really stopped the work up there? Too many of y'all was out there. And the white man is free to you. As long as the line up there was Cora originally started picketing, and there were more white picketing than black, nobody was worried. Plus, they started picketing on a cool day, and our people don't come out when it's cool. It was on a Wednesday, I think, and it was cool. And then on a Thursday, everybody came out there. They weren't demonstrating, but they came out there as spectators. And when all these black people and spectators began to stand there and watch, they were afraid. Because they knew that with the picketing, any little thing could happen. And even though you don't want to integrate, if the white man started beating some integrationist heads across the street, you couldn't stand there and watch it. Your nature wouldn't let you do it. And this is what would make you explode. He knows that. So he stopped the building of the hospital, but they have nothing but special in bringing the hall to any other construction in the city of New York outside of Harlem. So if they really meant to, they could have stopped that building over there in Brooklyn. That you can bring the hall to all the construction in New York City if those preachers are really for real. All they got to do is take all their congregations and take them down to Times Square. Tie it up. Now, I'm not talking Muslims aren't going to do this, but go and do something. And don't care what it costs. Don't care what the penalty or the price is. When you know you're right, you're right. And if you're not willing to go all the way, don't even start. Get on out of the line. Get on out of the bed. And that's another reason why we don't pick it with you. As Reverend said, we're not nonviolent. We have demonstrated. We pull a demonstration. But when we demonstrate, if you ever see us fall out in a demonstration, we are ready to die. Or we're ready to see that someone else died. I don't need no turn the other cheek. This is the only reason
that we don't become involved in these nonviolent demonstrations. Not fair. To walk up to a man nonviolently, he got a club in his hand. You're out of your mind. So you should check it and find out what's up, who is behind, and one of the leading men I saw out there that day was a white man named Herbert Hill. Herbert Hill is the labor secretary for NAACP. Now, it's Herbert Hill, a white man holding a top position in the NAACP, can come to house and stop the building of a hospital that's for the benefit of black people, if that white liberal really has your welfare at heart, let him go down now and stop some of these other construction sites. And until these white liberals, the white people, who call themselves liberals, can go into their own neighborhood and stop construction, don't let them come in Harlem and start telling you what to do. No, when you want them, if they want some action, you give them some action. And you'll bring about a change in your whole, in the entire direction of your program and of your struggle, and you'll get a job done. We want every black man and woman to have freedom. The freedom to accept or reject being separated from the slave master's children and establish a land of our own. And as the way said, give all of us freedom of choice. First, give every one of the 20 million black people in this country an opportunity to hear the truth. Let them be taught the truth about the white man and the truth about the black man. Let them be taught the truth about God and the truth about the devil. Let them be taught the truth about heaven and the truth about hell. And once they know the truth, then give them a chance to make a decision. But don't take this poor, dumb, deaf and blind, ignorant, brainwashed, so-called Negro and ask him what he wants. He doesn't know what he wants. And because he doesn't know what he wants, he tries to integrate with a blue-eyed wolf. Don't you know, anytime you see some sheep trying to integrate with wolves, those sheep are sick. Those sheep are out of their minds. And a sheep got more chance with a wolf than you got integrated with a white man. Why, a wolf can't be as hot on a sheep as a white man has been on you here in America. We want an immediate end to the police brutality and mob attacks against the so-called Negroes throughout the United States. Yes, a complete end to the police brutality and mob attacks that our people are confronted by every single day, every single week, every single month, every single year across the land. Brother, show me those pictures. Brother, grab that picture of Brother Ronald. Let me show you what I mean by police brutality and mob attack. Come over here with that. Here is a man, a Korean vet. This is a black man, a Korean vet. Went to war in Korea fighting for America. Risked his life fighting for America. And came back to this country and was shot down by the white man like a dog. Not some Ku Klux Klansman down in Mississippi. This black man was shot through the heart by policemen in Los Angeles, California. And they are dumb enough to think we have forgotten. Well, Muslim never forget. You don't kill our brother. We don't never forget. You don't shoot one of us and then grin in our face. You don't shoot one of us and shake our hands and think we forget it. No, we never forget. We'll never forget. Someone has to pay. Somewhere, somehow, someone has to pay. When a snake bites your children, you don't go and look for the snake that has blood on his jaws. Any old snake will do. Any old snake will do. They shot him through the heart. And as he lay dying on the sidewalk then, with police clubs, not in Mississippi, but in Los Angeles, California. Not in the South, right there in the North, in the West. Here it shows, men, black men, laid all over the sidewalk, shot down by police bullets. Not men who were guilty of some crime, not men who were drunk, not men who attacked anyone, but they shot their way into our mosque, shot their way into our religious sanctuary, and got the audacity to walk around here talking about them as a country based upon the principles of freedom of religion and freedom of worship and freedom of speech. This country is based upon nothing but hypocrisy. And it's based upon nothing but the right of white people to mutilate and shoot down black people. This is the brutality that we're talking about. This is the crime that we're talking about. And you say we teach hate. What kind of hate are we teaching? We're telling you what happens to black people. And this man didn't get shot down because he was a Muslim. They didn't ask him what his religion was. They saw that he was black and they began to fire point blank. And then when they went to court, these Gestapo, they were the criminal. They didn't go to court. They charged him. He's a dead man. And they charged him with a crime. Negro here sat down with charged with a crime, and you haven't heard anybody open their mouth about it. You wonder why you haven't trouble in this country. You haven't trouble because the devil is on the rampage. A blue-eyed devil is on the rampage. A heartless devil is on the rampage. A beast is on the rampage. And you haven't got sense enough to know how to handle it. So we don't try and handle it. God is going to handle it. We ask God to give him justice. We ask God to trap him. We ask God to catch him. We ask God to deal with him. And we pray that God deals with more of them day after day.
Right.
And what ones God don't get, we'll get them. For 8 weeks, 8 weeks in Los Angeles, 14 so-called Negroes sat on trial, charged by the police with assault, charged by the police with intent to commit murder. You haven't read anything about it in the papers. You haven't seen anything about it and heard anything about it from these blue-eyed white so-called liberals. They quieted it down. They hushed it up. And none of the Negro leaders opened up their mouths during the trial. They were silent. Why, they had a rally of 35,000 Negroes in one of those big Wrigley Fields in Los Angeles while the all-white jury was in session. And not one of them came forth and mentioned what had happened to those 14 Negroes in that city. And they wonder why things are developing to what they are today. No, you don't get justice in court. A black man can't get justice in court. A black man can't get justice in the court system of America. And I'm telling you, the only way you get justice is in the street. The only way you get justice is in the sidewalk. The only way you get justice is when you make justice for yourself. You never will get justice in the white man's court. No, not me. I never want him to take me to court. I saw what he did with my brothers. I see what he has done with him right here in New York City. So make sure you obey the law. Make sure you never commit a crime. Make sure you never deviate from the law. But any time one of them puts his hands on you, take him off the planet. Take him off the planet. Second class and paying full Pullman fare. Why, the conductor is out of his mind. as much as in the coat as they're paying in the college, Malachi. Because you don't pay first-class passage for a second-class seat. You have no business in a government as a second-class citizen paying first-class taxes. The government of the United States should exempt our people from all taxation as long as we are deprived of equal justice under the laws of the land. We believe that intermarriage or race mixing should be prohibited, and it should. We are against intermarriage. We don't want to see any black man with any white woman, and no white man with a black woman. Let the white man have his white woman, and let the black man have his black woman. And when you find these black women running around here, sneaking around with white men, catch them, straighten her out. I should say straighten her up and straighten him out. We believe in the truth that is in the Bible. But we don't believe in the lies that the white man has put in the Bible. We believe in Allah's prophets and the scriptures they brought to the people. We believe in the resurrection of the dead, not in the physical resurrection, but in mental resurrection. We believe that the so-called Negroes are most in need of mental resurrection. Therefore, they will be resurrected first. We believe in the resurrection of the dead, but not when you're physically dead. When you stop breathing and your heart stop beating and that man stick you in the ground, that's all she wrote. You are not going anywhere. Your soul isn't going anywhere. Your body isn't going anywhere. Nothing is happening after that. When you're dead, you are done. That's it. You can forget it. Then he says, all of it, what about the resurrection? He says that our people are dead. Negroes are dead. Walking zombies. You're the one that the book is talking about who is dead. Dead to the knowledge of yourself. Dead to the knowledge of your own people. Dead to the knowledge of your own God. Dead to the knowledge of the devil. Why, you don't even know who the devil is. The one down inside the ground. That's going to burn you after you're dead. Why, the devil is right here on top of this earth. He got blue eyes, blonde hair, white teeth, and he's giving you hell every day. And you still too dead to see it. We believe in the resurrection of the dead. We believe that the 20 million black people in America in the last days will be taught the truth. The trumpet of truth will sound in your ear. And it's being sounded today, the trumpet of truth. And this truth strikes your ear, strikes your heart. It'll open your eyes. It'll open your ears. It'll make you stand up. It'll do the same thing for you that truth did for the dry bones in the valley. Because the picture of dry bones in the valley is talking about you. The picture of Lazarus laying dead 4 days is talking about you. You are Lazarus. You are the dry bones. You are the prodigal son. You are the lost sheep. You are the people about whom the Bible is speaking who will stand up in the last day when the trumpet is sound. Black people are waking up. Black people are standing up. Black people are rising up and they're throwing sight into that knee-shaking white man. We believe we are the people of God's choice. That's what we believe. We believe we're the chosen people. We don't believe Jews are the chosen people. We don't believe Jews are the ones going to the promised land. We don't think Jews are a part of God. No, Jews are nothing but another part of that same race of devils that come out of Europe. They didn't even come out of the Holy Land. They come out of the caves of Europe. A Jew, a Frenchman, an Irishman, Italian, all of the same thing. A race of devils. They got different kinds. Germans, Irish, all of them the same thing. Just like you got a German Shepherd, an Irish Setter, a French Poodle, a Chihuahua, but they all dogs. We furthermore, we believe we are the people of God's choice. As it is written, that God would choose the rejected and despised. And we can find no other person fitting this description in these last days more than the so-called Negroes in America. We believe in the resurrection of the righteous. We believe in the judgment. We believe this first judgment will take place as God revealed right here in America. The judgment will take place in America. The resurrection will take place in America. The judgment will take place in America. The separation will take place in America. And the destruction will take place in America. Doom will take place in America. Doomsday will take place right here. This is the place the Bible is talking about. When the Bible mentions Babylon, it means America. When the Bible mentions Sodom and Gomorrah, that's America. When the Bible mentions Egypt, that's America. This is Rome. This is Babylon. This is that wicked kingdom that God is going to come and set fighting to in the last day. And you're living in that day right now. And I'm glad. We believe this is the time in history for the separation of the so-called Negroes and the so-called white Americans. We believe the black man should be free in name as well as in fact. By this we mean that we should be freed from the names imposed upon us by our former slave master. Murphy is not your name. Jackson is not your name. Smith is not your name. Bunch is not your name. Power is not your name. That's the white man's name. Those names go with blue-eyed people. Those names go with brown-haired people. Those names are not for black people. Your names come from the evil. You came from the evil. You should have some good names, some holy names, some names that don't connect you with the white man, but names that connect you with God. Not names that connect you with the devil, but names that connect you with God. Like Hassan, Jari, Rahman, Rahim, Hussan, Lumumba, Kenyatta, Nkrumah, Nyerere. Good names. Those names give you honor. When you walk around here saying your name is Murphy and Johnson and Jackson and that kind of crap, why, you don't do nothing but honor the white man. You let the world know who owns your grandfather. When you say it's Smith, that means some old white man named Smith owns your grandfather. And that's where you got your name. Names which identifies him as being the slave master's slave. We believe that if we are free indeed, we should go in our own people's name, the black people of the earth. We believe in justice for all. Whether in God or not, we believe as others that we are to do equal justice as human beings. We believe in equality as a nation of equals. We do not believe that we are equal with our slave masters in the status of free slaves. What do you mean? You and I can't walk around here saying we're equal to the white man. White man got all the factories, got all the stores, all the businesses, all the schools, and you're going to tell us we're equal with him? No, we're not equal until we make ourselves equal. We're not equal until we have what he has. Until we have for ourselves what he has for himself. When he runs up his flag, we need a flag that we can run. When he breaks out his army, we need our army. He come up with his navy, we need our navy. He have his air force, we need our air force. He have his bullets, we need our bullets. Then when we got the same thing that he has, we're equal. But as long as we're begging him for what he has, we're not equal to him. We recognize and respect American citizens as independent people. And we respect their laws which govern the nation. And is it true? We don't love any white man, but we respect his law. We obey his law. You won't find us pretending to love them. They're not worthy of our love. But we respect their law. We respect their flag. We respect their government. We don't believe in it, but we respect it. We respect authority. We respect those who have positions of authority. But that doesn't mean we have to love those people or like those people or trust those people. They are not worthy of our trust. And they are not worthy of our love. And they won't get our love. The patient is hypocritical and is made by those who are trying to deceive the black people into believing that their 400-year-old open enemy of freedom, justice, and equality all of a sudden are their friends. Furthermore, we believe that such deception is intended to prevent black people from realizing that the time in history has arrived for the separation from the white people of this nation. If the white people are truthful about their professed friendship toward the so-called Negro, they can prove it by dividing up America with their slaves. We do not believe that America will ever be able to furnish enough jobs for her own millions of unemployed white people, in addition to jobs for the 20 million black people. The white man, he wants you to remain a boy. He wants you to remain a lackey. He wants you to remain dependent on him. He wants you to come looking to him for some kind of advice or some kind of teacher. No, you teach yourself and stand up for yourself and respect yourself and know yourself and defend yourself and be yourself, and you'll be recognized as an intelligent person. I purposely say the government, that's who it is, FBI. CIA, they sneak around here in Harlem trying to frighten you into thinking that if you be a Muslim, you're going to catch hell. You already caught hell. You can't catch any more hell than you have caught. In this form of harassment.
They engage in such harassment because the American government wants to turn you against your own kind. In order to keep you from making a mass exodus out of this country, back to your own country, where you can live among your own kind. So the American propaganda is designed to make you think that no matter how much hell you get here, you are still better off here in America than you would be elsewhere. This is their trick. They want you to think you have no place else to go. And many of our so-called Negro intellectuals who posed as our leaders and our spokesmen actually believe that our people have no place else to go. And so this type of leader can only offer a solution designed to make us stay here and continue to get hell patient in the hope that someday the white man will have a change of heart and recognize us too as human beings and then accept us into his white society. You never will have peace here. You never will have security here. You never will have hospitality from white people here. You'll spend another 1,000 years exposed to the hypocrisy and false promises of the white man. Now, brothers and sisters,
we believe that we who declared ourselves to be righteous Muslims should not participate in wars which take the lives of humans. As Muslims, we don't go to war. We don't get dressed. We don't join anybody's army. We don't teach you not to go because they put us in jail for sedition. I would never tell you not to go. I wouldn't be that dumb. But I sure would tell you if you're dumb enough to go, that's up to you. If you're dumb enough to fight for someone who means you no good, if you're dumb enough to fight for something that you have never gotten, if you are dumb enough to be as dumb as your other brothers who went into Korea and came back and still caught hell, if you're dumb enough to follow in the footsteps of your older brothers during World War II who fought all over the South Pacific like Isaac Porter and came back here to this country and got his eyes punched out by police right here in this country, if you are dumb enough behind what you know about the white man today to let him stick his uniform on you and send you overseas to fight, well, you go to hell on in front. But I'm not that dumb. For me, and I can only speak for myself, I'll go to jail. I'll go to prison. Stick me in jail. Let me go to prison. Right. But don't give me your uniform. And don't give me your rifle, because I might use it on someone that you don't intend for me to use. Oh, never put me in your airplane and fill it with bombs and tell me go bomb the enemy. Well, I don't have the power to go to find that enemy. No. We do not believe that this nation should force us to take part in such war. But we have nothing to gain from it unless America agrees to give us necessary territory wherein we may then have something to fight for. Give us part of this country. And then if it's attacked, we got something to fight for. But the days are gone when you think you can draft this little black man who's sitting up here in the slums and ghettos of Harlem, who receives nothing but the worst schools and the worst education, who can't even get a decent job. Why, that cracker is out of his mind. If he thinks our people are dumb enough to go run after him today into some kind of war that he's going to instigate and start for his own mercenary benefit. Those days are over. We believe, yes, let him fight his own war. Let him fight his own battle. If you and I can't fight in Mississippi, we got no business fighting over someplace else. If we're going to be nonviolent at home, we're going to be nonviolent abroad. We believe our women should be respected and protected as the women of other nationalities are respected and protected. And as I said at our last rally, the reason you never see any of our Muslim sisters out here, we fear that you will molest them. You might step on one. You might nudge one. And when you put your hands on a Muslim sister, we are obligated by our religion to let your head roll in the street. We are obligated. We are religiously obligated to take the life of the man who disrespects our women. And 4 policemen on that corner one night, I was told a week later, had the audacity to approach one of our sisters. And I think that the word should go around that this is the wrong thing to do. This is a dangerous thing to do. In fact, it's dangerous anywhere in Harlem today for a white man to show disrespect to a black woman. It's dangerous for the white man to do this. And I think you'll agree it is dangerous. We believe that we're at the time now when God, the Prince of Peace, has a desire to set up his kingdom here on this earth. But we do not believe that God can establish a kingdom of peace until he first removes from the planet the warmonger, the warmaker, the troublemaker. So today, we believe religiously that God is after the white man, that God is rounding them up, that God is bringing them together, dumping them all in one spot for the sole purpose of casting all of them into the lake of fire. We religiously believe that when you read the book of Revelation, and it points out in there about the beast in the last days that was cast into the lake of fire as Muslim, we believe that this means none other than the American white man. We believe that his future is a fiery future, a future in which he will be enveloped in the flames that will stem from God's wrath. And because we believe this religiously, we respect him, but we don't have any desire to be integrated with him. We want to be separated from him. We want to please God. We want to get on God's side so God will be on our side. We want to make ourselves acceptable to God. We don't want to make ourselves acceptable to the white man. We're not trying to impress the white man. We shake his hand, we show him respect, but we're not trying to make no love with the white man. Let him love his own kind and let us love our own kind. Let him unite his own kind and let us unite our own kind. Let him live in his neighborhood and let us live in our neighborhood. Let him run his community and let us run our community. If the white men cops are going to be in the white community, let us have some black ones. Let us have some black precincts. Let us have some black merchants. Let us have some black stores. Let us have something black in a black community. We are tired of looking into the face of these blue-eyed exploiters who are taking advantage of our people. I've enjoyed it. Brothers and sisters, I want, in the name of Allah, the all-wise, true and living God, the one to whom all praise is due, we thank him together in unity and harmony. As you know, the white man is always looking for you to cut out, stop something that he can blame on us. So as you disperse from this meeting this afternoon, we want you to be cool, calm, collected. Don't let anyone hurt you or provoke you into becoming involved in any kind of trouble. On the other hand, we still don't teach you to turn the other cheek. We don't in any way at any time teach you to turn the other cheek.